Hello, here's the much-requested tour of my 48-year-old Microplus 600 cabin cruiser, which I've just bought as an economical way to keep a foot on the water. First of all, here's a glance over the entire boat, then we'll get into some specifics. Starting at the bow, there's a small anchor locker and aluminium handrails and fairleads. A rubber bumper strip runs around the side for limited protection against impacts. And it could do with having a jet wash, quite frankly, there's loads of muck in there. You'll also, no doubt, have noticed quite a bit of cracking in the gel coat. Well, the boat is almost 50, so it shouldn't come as a surprise. And yes, there are one or two bits that are quite bad, but it's all something that can be sanded back and refilled with new gel epoxy. I just need to match the colour. Two windows face forwards, and as far as I can tell, don't leak, thankfully. Above the cabin, there's a hatch, though as you can see, this has a solar panel on top of it, which prevents the hatch being opened. This is something I want to address, but there's nowhere else on the boat that the panel could sensibly go. The bracket holding the panel on is rather ugly, and will be changed. A 12-volt light provides basic illumination in tunnels. It's not very bright, mind you. In front of the cockpit, there's a shallow windscreen with pop studs onto it to which a plastic canopy is attached. This seems to keep the rain out. Down the side of the boat are plenty of windows, though their shape is awkward for making curtains, as you'll see when we go inside. There are navigation lights, should you be so bold as to travel at night, and behind them are handrails for assistance when boarding. A centre line is also tied on there. Here's the cockpit side. It's very awkward getting aboard here, because the poles holding up the canopy get completely in the way. You'll have noticed it's a centre cockpit, as there is a tiny back cabin too. If we look around the back, there's the outboard motor clamped to the transom with control cables coming from the cockpit. The outboard's a Honda 4-stroke, apparently from the 1980s, so I'm told, and it runs very well, but it does spit petrol out when you start it, which is not good. You can just see the rudder clamped to the prop under the water too. Here's the cockpit with the canopy side raised. There's space for four to sit, two behind two. And that's the door to the back cabin. The front seats have folding backs. The glass is there to catch and release spiders. Nothing inspires confidence more than gaffer tape on the controls. There are three fire extinguishers aboard. Someone took the boat safety scheme requirements quite seriously, as you'll see. Unfortunately, there's water coming in from somewhere. It looks very clear, so I think it's rainwater.
I must say I'm quite glad about this little lip between the centre cabin and the forward cabin, as that's preventing the water getting in there. At least I hope it is. That sealant down the bottom has pretty much come away. It's not doing a very good job. I need to reseal that. Also, while we're here, clearly whoever stained the doors brown did it with them in situ without any newspaper, because there's lots of little brown splashes and stains everywhere.
There are other oddities like this random hole which would probably let water into the bilge. But why? Here's the maker's plate in the cockpit. Microplus has a convoluted history. The view ahead from the passenger seat, it's not great with the canopy in place. And the same from the driver's side. I think I'd like to put a different wheel on, or refurb this one. On the side is the throttle and gear control. Forwards for forwards, backwards for backwards. And it annoys me immensely that the electrics panel is on sideways. That is doing my head in. Even uglier is the way the leads come down from the solar panel, being run along the side and taped onto the cockpit. Ugh. There's more tape holding them below the throttle, then they disappear off into this hole to the battery system, which we'll come to. Speaking of this hole, those are the throttle and gear cables running to the back, and other things I don't know yet, which need some investigation. The passenger side has a similar hole with a fire blanket, but also you'll note a gas supply pipe, which is odd, as there's no gas in use on the boat. And by gas I mean propane, so we're clear. This could come out. Above the door to the front cabin is a somewhat ugly block of wood. I'm not actually sure what purpose this is serving, other than maybe keeping the odd raindrop off. These nasty screws, with their cracks in the gel, are holding up the electrics panel inside. It really should have been fastened on this sloping surface behind the steering wheel, because that way there'd be a totally flat area on which to put maps, snacks and other paraphernalia. Okay, let's head inside into the cute little cabin.
I'm just going to interrupt myself doing the tour for a little pitch of an idea to you, which I hope you will find useful, and I mean this hand on heart seriously. The thing is, Christmas is coming, and if you're like me, you're very bad at buying presents for people. I know that when I go out to buy Christmas presents, I come back with presents for me. I'm supposed to be buying for family and friends, and I'll go, oh, I like that, oh, I like that, oh, I like that. And I come home with a load of shopping. It's all for me, and I haven't bought presents for anyone else. But this year, I do have what I think is going to be the solution, and that is the Holskern website, and they are the sponsor of today's video. And before you roll your eyes and go, oh, sponsor, no, listen, I think this could be a game changer in terms of Christmas present buying, certainly for me, because they are a designer of watches, men's and women's, and jewellery and handbags and sunglasses, and they have a vast range. They've got over 1,000 designs, which means there is something for everyone. This watch is from Holskern. I got it off them last time I did a sponsor promo, and I wear it every day. I didn't just put it on for the promo. It is now my daily watch because I like it so much. I like the colour of it. I like the chunkiness of it. I like the fact that the stopwatch dial there uses a tiny bit of meteorite rock. And they use loads of other interesting materials as well. They've got watches with marble as the watch face. They do a lot with wood, where the watch strap and the bezel is made out of lovely polished wood. It's all FSC certified, so no deforestation or anything like that. But they've got this vast range of products, and that means I can find gifts for people as well as more presents for me. And because it's Christmas, they are guaranteeing, which is bold, delivery for all orders placed by the 20th of December. What is more, free and easy returns until mid-January, should you wish to return a product for any reason whatsoever. Now, I've got a discount code, of course I have, and a link in the description below. So go click on the link, have a browse of the website, use the discount code, and I can pretty much guarantee that whoever you're looking for, you'll find something that they will like on the Holskern website. And if you're someone who doesn't celebrate Christmas or whatever, well, bookmark it anyway, because there's always birthdays and other events for which you might need to be buying presents. Delivery is free, worldwide shipping, and they take care of all pesky customs and taxes. So basically, you order the product and it will turn up and there won't be any issues with it. Have a look at the website, use my discount code, link in the video description below, and your Christmas present buying woes will surely be over. Now, back to the tour.
The bulk of the forward cabin is taken up with a V-berth, two single beds or seats angled in a V-shape. When sleeping, your feet would go up the front. Remove the cushions and there's a limited amount of storage under each seat. Here, the port side has my life jacket in the locker. There's a similar but smaller hole at the bow with an oddly oversized bit of wood as a cover. I thought a water tank might be in there, but it isn't.
I can't help but notice this wood feels rather damp and clearly has signs of damp. Now, whether that's just condensation or a leak from the window, I don't know. It's not hugely damp, but it is damp, and has clearly been so in the past. Everything else around it, though, is dry, which is good, and there's no evidence of water in the actual locker.
Let's talk about those windows and the curtain rails above and below, whose shape means the end of the curtain will have to be sloped, because if you drop a straight edge of curtain down from there, it'll leave part of the window exposed. My sister's offered to make me some curtains, so she has that challenge. The next window along can be slid open for ventilation, which is nice, and it has a simple lock for when it's closed. I accidentally left this open for 2 weeks when we had a storm come by, and amazingly, not a drop of water seemed to come in, as the cushions and carpet were bone dry afterwards, which was rather pleasing. These are the front windows, fairly obviously, and again, no sign of leaks. In the ceiling, just as you come in, is a ventilation duct and spider access point. And there's the underside of the hatch with the solar panel on top of it. This grotty bit of wood is the panel behind the steering and electrical controls, the one that's been screwed upwards into the nice shelf in the cabin. Below that, on the right as you come in, is a sink with a simple self-pumped cold water tap. There's a wooden cover that can go on top, but I'll probably remake the whole of this. Down below is a cupboard with some overly chunky doors and latches. So as to get the lie of the land, on the opposite side, on the left as you come in, is the cooking area, which currently houses the portable gas stove. A little shelf underneath houses some odds and sods left by a prior owner, and there's another unattractive set of doors to a cupboard below that. However, there's a surprise in store. Take off the shelf with the cooker on it, remove the shelf below that, and there's a toilet-shaped hole. It seems originally there would have been some kind of potty under here, though that would mean putting the toilet lid here where the shelf was and pooing underneath your cooker. At present, there's just a storage space underneath with one of the boards that makes the V-berth into a double bed. And there are some weights, presumably to balance out the batteries on the other side, which I'll come to in a minute. A shelf sits against the back bulkhead. It's useful, but I'll remake this too. The whole cabin is carpeted, though I'm pondering ripping this off, adding a small layer of foam insulation, and then re-carpeting with the campervan stretch carpet. At the rear bulkhead, some black tape does a bad job of hiding some wiring, that then does a bad job of hiding in the ceiling board, and ends with a dangling connector of no apparent purpose. Why? Just why? I will take this out. The wobbly table between the berths is not a suitable place for a full cup of tea, as I discovered to my cost. The leg ought to be sturdy, so I'm not sure why it's so wobbly, but I've never liked this type of table leg anyway. Now, who's ready for a little surprise below the sink? Yes, it's the electrics, underneath where the water goes. Brilliant! There's the sink inlet and outlet pipes, and there's the batteries below. I'm sure the water tank ought to be here, but there isn't one. Maybe it could squeeze under the cabin seats? It's a bit cramped there, though. Right, those electrics. Three batteries, of which two are one size, plus another that's different. That's not ideal. To be fair, they're strapped down and use some suitably chunky cables, which is good. There's a solar charge controller, and the prior owner added the surge protector switch as well as a 12-volt fuse box. The whole lot has been firmly stuck to the fiberglass with foam, which is going to make relocating this a sticky nightmare. I don't like the look of that tape. And look, another random connector dangling at the back. What is that all about? Oh, good, there's a master cut-off switch. But hang on, that looks a little odd. Oh, yes, it's not actually connected, it was just sitting there. This kit is all fine, though. I can definitely reuse this. Worse is the state of the cupboard doors and hinges. They don't open properly. That's as far as it goes. It just springs the door back. They're nasty hinges with odd screws and loads of old holes from previous doors that haven't been filled. Look at that, the hinge is bent. Oh dear, I'm going to need a big tub of fiberglass filler. Why did nobody ever fill the old holes in? I like the sockets and switches, but I will remake this box. A CO alarm above is good to see, and next to it is the cabin fire extinguisher.
Even if I can just get the sink hooked up to some sort of permanent water supply, only cold, but just something so I can pump water into the sink fairly easily instead of messing around with cartons, and also get some curtains on the window, those two things alone would make a massive difference, because bringing the boat back with no curtains and having to muck about with jugs of water, it just made life difficult. And it would make life a lot easier if I could draw the curtains at night and pump the little tap on the sink to get some water to clean my teeth. And the other plan is to replace this portable camping stove, which was just a temporary measure, and put a single induction hob here, for which I'm going to have to beef up the whole battery setup anyway and put an inverter, and then I'll have a little travel kettle, effectively replicating what I did in my camper van on a smaller scale.
Back in the cockpit, there are two passenger seats moulded into the fiberglass. Between them is a hatch to the back cabin. This just lifts up on a hinge and stays in place through blind faith. There are grab handles, though these become obscured by the canopy even when it's down. Let's go inside. The rear cabin is clearly intended for kids, as the berths on either side are quite short. There's one currently being occupied by the portable toilet and the block of wood that was sitting above the sink. The toilet is old but serves its purpose, and you can see a child's feet would go underneath the back of the cockpit, although this space has another fire extinguisher and a first aid kit, plus another CO alarm, and on the sidewall a fire alarm. It's all good because of the engine's proximity. This little solar panel, which is half obscured by the sidewall anyway, charges a small battery under there, which powers a bilge pump. While it's nice to have a bilge pump, the installation is ugly to say the least, with the power wires gaffer-taped down the edge of the cabin and the waste pipe bodged into the floor through a chunk someone cut out of the fiberglass sole. Isn't this just the most bizarre arrangement? There must have been a less intrusive route for this overflow pipe to take.
As an inspection hatch, if it wasn't coming away from the floor, that would have been fine. What's weird about it is this giant hole gouged out of the floor to take this giant pipe from the bilge pump. Now, that surely could have been done in a more elegant manner. I'm clearly going to have to reseal that mounting, fill that hole, and bring this pipe out in a better way. Pleasingly, it is dry down there. Less pleasingly, there is trace water at the back. Just a little bit of damp. I don't think it's canal water. I think it's rainwater.
Because if you look out here at the back where the motor is, there's this bizarre little catchment area for the rain. And I think it's that water is leaking through under there. Which begs the question, how do we stop it? There's some very old sealant down there which is coming away. That's easily replaced. But it seems to me peculiar to have this trough to catch rain here anyway. And yes, there is a drain hole there, so it will only ever reach a certain level. I suppose that'll suffice. So what I need to do is just seal that again so nothing's coming through.
Access to the outboard is through this little hinged door, but the entire door section is itself set into a triangular mounting which is removable, being fastened to the hull by some screw retainers and a set of clip clamps underneath. Clamped onto the transom is the outboard, which, as people have noticed, is offset from centre. There's the fuel primer hand pump, with a dodgy looking connection for the emergency cut-off wiring, which also acts as the ignition switch. That's the cable controlling the gearbox, and here's where the steering cables push the motor left and right. This thick black cable is the throttle, which enters next to the choke. I cannot read the oil level on that sight gauge to save my life. The spiders seem to like it. Back in the cabin, the other berth has a bag of mooring gear, as well as an anchor, some deck chairs, my spare fuel cartons, and the main fuel tank, which I'm pleased to see does at least go through a fuel filter with a whole bag of spares. There's no gauge on the fuel tank, which is annoying, as you have to peer at the level in the tank and slosh it about to see what's going on. I noticed while filming that there is a gap in the join between the floor of this back cabin and that of the cockpit, so maybe the water in the cockpit is the leak in the back cabin draining through. Elsewhere, there are numerous little chips and holes in the gel coat which will need drilling out and filling, if only I can match the colour, which I fear will be tricky. If anyone actually knows the RAL or Pantone reference for Microplus yellow, please let me know.
And that, I think, is pretty much it. It is an old boat. It is 48 years old, I think, and so I think we can excuse it some lines and wrinkles, much like myself. All sorts of potential things I can do here, but do you know what? It's a fun little boat. And as I was coming along here today, to just check on it. I found myself smiling, just smiling at the thought that I was coming to my boat. And isn't that what the best kind of boating is all about? Thanks for watching. Cheerio.
And don't forget to visit holskern.com/cruisingthecut for your Christmas gifts.